Frederick Noronha is a freelance journalist who has founded a book publishing initiative in Goa in 2007 called Goa 1556. The view from my window is his blog, which is absolutely interesting. I have read it myself, and very interesting articles. He is currently teaching at the Goa University, and it is my privilege to interview him. So, in conversation with Frederick Noronha. Good evening,
yeah,
Frederick.
Hi.
So, to start off, your story is really inspiring because you started out as a commerce student, and then you pursued your master's, then you got into journalism, and then creative writing. So, describe that journey, you know, the transition from commerce to all these.
See, when you're my age, you know, Kimberly, you kind of, if you look back, it sometimes seems as if we had some grand plan about how life should proceed. But the fact of the matter is that we just played it by ear. I stumbled along, I reached where I reached. I had no, you know, kind of plan or projection of where I wanted to be in 10, 20, 30 years. Of course, I did have certain interest in mind. And I always followed my heart. I always believed in doing what I enjoyed doing. So nothing else was an issue to me. But the fact is I didn't have any plans. I didn't know where I was going. I stumbled along. I'm quite happy with what I did. If I had a second chance, I would have probably done it again. I was a journalist first. It's not that I did my MA first. I was a journalist at the age of 19 when I was still in my third year. And then I felt that I needed to, get some English language qualifications because I was always under the fear that one day someone in the newspaper would say, you go and work in our commerce, in our accounts department.
Okay.
You know, so because of that, I came and did MA in English, and I was, you know, more in the library than in the classroom. I'm not a great student.
So, but did that MA help you with your journalism?
You know, as I was saying, my greatest benefit from the Goa University then, it was just being set up 1985 to 87,
okay,
was the library. I learned so much from it. I picked up so much, you know, so in a class sense, in how much I learned from a class, our teachers were great and they were nice people.
Okay.
And I happened to meet P. Lal, who influenced us because he had this book publishing firm. So there were influences, there were lessons learned. But I don't know how much formal qualifications really help. No? So that's why I'm always telling students, what you pick up outside the class is going to be much more useful than inside.
Yes, sir. So, and why did you choose to write?
You know, I didn't choose to write, but as the cliche goes, writing chose me in that sense. I love to write, I love to read. And if you read a lot, it's natural that you're going to write at some stage. Because you have these opinions, you have these ideas which you want to share. And writing is a great way of sharing it. No, I mean, it's like teaching on a larger scale.
So you've written a book, Another Goa, which is a tribute to the place you call home. So why did you, like, were you passionate about writing about your place, or what was your aim? What is your purpose behind writing that book?
You know, actually, people make this mistake into thinking that I'm a great Goan at heart, and I'm one of these guys who's passionately in love with Goa and all. I'm very clinical about the place. I like the place, I know the place, I understand the place. You know, if I was in some other place, I might have said the same about that other place. So it is a bit of a special place because I understand it, but it's not that I'm in love with it or like, you know, I think it's better than any other places. No, every place has its own charm. But having said that, I do understand the place. I take pride in the fact that, you know, I have this huge collection of Goa books which I have been collecting for the last 20, 30 years, maybe 2,000 or 3,000 of them. And, you know, I think we need to all specialize in some area which we take an interest in. So in that sense, I like Goa because I could understand it. It's not always been like this. So I came back from Brazil where my parents had migrated at the age of 2. And understanding Goa was so difficult then, you know. So it was always a challenge to me in terms of how do we understand the place. And over the years, I think I've come to some understanding of it, first as a journalist, then as a book collector, then as a book reviewer, then as a book publisher. So to a certain extent, you know, I think we all should try to be some footnote somewhere in some field which we feel about.
So you encourage us a lot to write, and you think that we possess the talent, you know, to write. So do you envision our generation to be good writers?
Absolutely. I mean, why not? You know, I am always surprised by the kind of talent I see among the young people. And this is not, you know, a cliche that I'm just repeating because everyone says you're the future generation. No, you all are privileged in a sense that, you know, you all have access to things which we never had, which our generation didn't have, whether it's a net, whether it's, you know, information at a global scale, or in our times, whether it is a time, whether it's a luxury to do these things, whether it is, you know, the surplus to spend on these things. And I think writing is so important. Every society needs its own writers.
Yes.
If you don't tell your story, who is going to tell your story? I mean, we can't expect someone from the US or Mars or somewhere to come and tell our story. And when we tell the story, it's very different from someone else telling the story, no? So, over the years, I've seen the dramatic changes happening in my own lifetime. In the 60s, there were no books for children. I'm not talking about Goa, I'm talking about India as a whole. You know, there were very few, very limited number of books. Today, there is a plethora of books, there's a plethora of opportunities for you all to write. And there is talent bubbling all the time, like, you know, the kind of short stories that young people write. I still feel that we don't have enough opportunity to air them. But once that happens, you know, so we need to have enough talent, we need to have the space for that talent to express itself. Once that happens, you'll see magic happening. You'll see prominent writers coming out from Goa. We've already, you know, have big names without mentioning any.
Okay.
There are quite a few.
So do you think the social media can accelerate this process, like, of,
yeah,
you know, making unknown authors, like, known, like, you know, the good ones, bringing them,
yeah,
out in the limelight?
See, I don't want to get caught up in this thing of saying that you write, there's millions waiting for you at the end of the tunnel. You know, it's a lonely battle, it's an uphill struggle. Many try, a few succeed.
Yeah.
That apart, let's not create any illusions. But having said that, you know, talent is growing all the time. You can see it. What you have now, we never had in the past. You know, in our college days, the best we could hope for was some college magazine, which was cyclostyle, put together with a cover drawn, you know. It was called Bridges, I remember, and things like that. But today, you have many more opportunities for you all to express yourself, and students are taking to them amazingly, and social media is playing its role in terms of exposing, you know, people to the rest of the world. And because you're coming from a small state, it doesn't mean that you're not as good as someone from a big place. So you have at least, you know, a level playing field there. So, you know, I think there's a lot of potential. Let's see.
So you're very active on social media.
I'm a big time spammer.
Facebook, you're
I'm a big time spammer. I'm a big time spammer. Like, so
you
if
need
people
to come on Instagram. You need to.
Yeah,
Instagram.
I'm too old for that. But but you know, yeah, I mean, Instagram is 19, 20 year old stuff. I don't know, somehow I know not got onto Instagram, maybe I'm a slow starter, but you know, I think
so you're passionate about photography. I think Instagram is
an
awesome platform where you can, you know, showcase this talent and this passion of yours.
See, I learned half of my tricks from 19, 20, 21 year old. So, you know, we had this Linux user group, which is a kind of free software open source group.
Okay.
And in 2006 or 2007, they said, you know, why don't you join Twitter, something like this.
Okay.
So it was really early in the day when I managed to join Twitter. And my claim to fame today is that I have a two letter username, which is FN, like just FN, like, you know, someone from the Gulf was willing to buy it for me. I don't know. I didn't negotiate. There's this French racist party called the National Front by its French initials FN, whom I keep on instigating, like, you know, once in a way spamming them and things like that. So people think that I'm them and they are me. And, you know, So I'm saying that talking about social media, our experience with social media goes back a bit earlier. We are from the email generation, 1994 to be precise, when the first mailing list in Goa started, GoaNet and things like that. And some of us journalists who were facing a tough time to express ourselves,
yes,
would actually log in there and post our articles and share news and things like that, because there were very few media opportunities then.
Okay. So, what advice would you give to yourself 20 years back?
Maybe I'm a stupid donkey, but I would say do everything the same way you did it. Trust your heart.
Okay.
Don't go for the big bucks. Enjoy yourself. Have fun while you're doing it. You know, even if you don't have all the answers, do it. If your heart tells you something that this is what I would enjoy doing, you know, this is what I would not like to spend the next 30 years of my life doing. Believe in yourself, have faith in yourself.
Okay, so now I wanted to ask you, does a good piece of writing always have colorful language?
You know, it really
how
varies.
Would you judge a good piece of writing by using these like a specific jargon or words or what?
You know, as a sociologist might say, every writing has a social context, so every culture has its own style. What is a good piece of writing in English is not necessarily a good piece of writing in some other language. What is a good piece of writing today may not be a good piece of writing, may have not been in the 17th century or in the 22nd century. So, you know, that keeps varying. In journalism, again, they have their own style. So, like Hemingway, who is considered to be such a great writer, writes in this very simple and, you know, shown off flowery kind of peppering style. I guess, yeah, it depends what genre you're talking about. And
okay.
You know, as journalists, we are taught to be hacks. We are plain hacks. We want to get the message across. We want to make the language simple. There's not much space for being colorful. Some forms of journalism, yes, it is there. But I think the bottom line is, what are you trying to say? Can you express your ideas simply? Can you express your ideas, spread it fast, make a strong point? That's it. Other forms of writing,
yes. Do you believe
in
this? Simplicity is the best?
As a journalist with my background there, I would say,
okay.
You know. Yeah.
Does a good writer have to be a good reader? Like, does
yeah.
your reading influence what you write?
Yeah, so you know, there was this debate once on the net, and I just wanted to be a contrarian like I normally am. And you know, I searched the net for alternative arguments to this, and the closest I could get was, if you want to be a good cook, do you have to be, you know, a gourmet in that sense? Do you have to eat a lot of good food to be a good cook? Of course, it's a strange question to ask, but to be honest, I think if you want to write well, you have to read a lot. Because you're not only picking up vocabulary, you're picking up writing styles, you're picking up ideas, you're subconsciously being influenced by, you know, people who have tried it and been there before us. So why, for example, I would ask is, say, Devanagari Kokani writing, you know, considered to be better than Romi. Partly because the writers are also influenced by writers from other worlds, and they read a lot, and you know, they are into reading Marathi contemporary stuff. So if you don't read, there's a limit on how much you can think of originally, I would say.
So whenever I've tried to write, I'm always faced with a writer's block.
Mm.
Has that, you know, occurred to you?
Yeah.
Have you experienced this?
It can happen, fortunately not too much. Only in the last decade, because I'm into publishing, I'm wearing my editor's hat and my businessman's hat, and you know, I've gone out of this creativity thing.
Okay.
But when I was, you know, primarily based on being a freelance but full-time journalist, I would make sure of make it a point to write for 2 hours, 4 hours, 6 hours, whatever, every day. Make it a point to write some way, and then when it's routine, there's no way you can, you know, jump out of it. But if you stop and start and all, writer's block is a serious issue, and it affects many people, and it will manifest itself in all kinds of ways, and you'll find all kinds of ingenious excuses of why you should not do it, why you cannot do it. It's terrible once you're caught in it.
Okay. So does your family support your artistic process?
It's a tough question to answer, because you know, I'm my ideas are quite crazy, so they have supported it quite a lot. Most of the time they have supported it, except when it becomes too much for them in that
mm-hmm.
sense. So my kids always grumble and say that, you know, you have three kids. Actually, I have two.
Mm-hmm.
They say Goa 1556 is your third kid,
mm-hmm.
and it's your most favorite because it's the youngest, and you know, kind of, you know, a bit grudging, but they fully support it. They support it quite a lot, and they go out of their way, especially my daughter who,
okay.
you know, being this father-daughter relationship, she's my one woman fan army, so to speak. My son has his own views, and it's a bit more difficult to convince him, though he's younger. My wife has been very supportive at various points. So like, for example, when we started out, you know, we were just married, and this thing of whether I should go in for a modem in that sense. And I remember like I was in my 20s and my life savings was like 60 or 70,000 rupees and a modem then cost 14,000 rupees, like one fourth of it. And she said, you know what you're doing, just do it, she said, like, no. So that kind of confidence when someone gives you, it's like, it's like a carte blanche. You feel sure of doing it. You get that confidence. Of course, along the way, sometimes they have their differences of how to do things and all, that's fine. But by and large, I'm quite a strong-minded person.
So the saying still, is true, like, behind every successful man, there is a woman.
Actually, my wife might feel quite offended by that because, she's the kind of person who won't introduce herself as Frederick Noronha's wife and all. She's a woman in her own right. And
I go on telling people I am associated with you.
Yeah, whatever. So, yeah, one day, when all of you all reach some place in life, at that stage, I'm going to say, they were my students. Even if I taught you for 2 minutes or I did some interview with you, I'm going to claim credit. So, you better be ready for it.
Explain this to me now. Often we get intimidated by famous people. See, I googled you and
I'm not famous.
He is famous. Trust me, Google him. So I've googled you and these famous people are very intimidating and not very approachable. But you are on a different level. You're a buddy more than a teacher.
No.
You're a friend to us.
No.
So how do you maintain that?
See, you're getting it wrong because, if you're talking about the online world, I'm a big time spammer and I have a huge kind of, fake presence there. I won't call it fake, but, actually it's because to stop joking, I believe in sharing whatever I have because of this free software influence on me and all. So I've been sharing information articles after I've got them sold and I've been sharing it for like 20-25 years. So that creates a slightly larger than life, much larger than life image. You come to my house in my village and you ask for me by name, no one will know me. You have to ask,
A prophet is never known in his own town.
You have to ask for me by my pet name, which
is... What is your pet?
Forget about that. So yeah, they call me Rico there. So if you ask where is Rico's house, and then they'll say, okay, there are two brothers and something that they'll remember, like what I was 25 years back and the papers which I worked for 25 years. So whatever. So that way, I don't take myself too seriously. I think that, we shouldn't take ourselves too seriously because, the worst thing, most of us in our field, we take ourselves very seriously, because we have this larger than life image and we think like, oh, we are celebrities. No, we are not. You're as good as your last story, you're as good as the paper you work for. As long as you have some social media behind you, you are recognized for your work. Apart from that, what are you? I call myself a paper tiger because if you have a paper behind us, we are tigers. Otherwise, we are just like, So I think not taking yourself seriously is important if you want to grow.
Okay. Do you Google yourself?
Actually, not only Google myself, I'm a bit worse than that. There's some site called Ego Boo or something. I don't know if it's still around. It's like Ego Boost.
Oh, okay.
So you can actually check where you are and things like that. So, I have been guilty of that. Like, my famous, when I have time to waste, I Google for my name and see what pictures come up with it. And some strange pictures of people I photographed and all do come up with it. So, I'm guilty of that. Sometimes you just want to see what people are saying. It's not that people are talking about you or they have nothing else to discuss, but sometimes you find strange things about yourself which you didn't know.
No, but speaking of strange, you must have come across negative criticism.
Yeah, of course.
How did you
deal
with that?
Of course. Once you're out there, and especially if you become this larger than life image, people throwing stones is a natural kind of tendency. You don't mind if it is right, then you say probably I deserve it. Now, as a youngster, I read this essay, 10 ways of handling an insult.
Okay.
And they give you 10 different ways of handling it. And the 10th way is if you can't manage any of the above 9, you probably deserve it.
Okay.
So if you deserve it, then fair enough. No, like I made some mistakes somewhere, they are right. sometimes you just don't deserve it, and they are bizarre, like then you can laugh it off. But the most dangerous thing is when there's a mix of fact and fiction. So once this friend of mine, actually two friends, one wrote a humor column with me in it, and one guy wrote a short story with me in it. And I got so bugged, you know, after I, without taking names, I won't tell you who these guys are. At some stage
do
I told, I mean, this time I was surprised with myself, because I said, like, he's mixing fact with fiction, and people who don't know me are either going to think that the full thing is fact. Yeah. You know, so there were elements which were true and there were elements which were totally fictional. So I told this guy, I said, please don't.
Pieces?
Yeah, they are somewhere there. I said, please don't. I'll share them with you. It's quite funny. I said, please don't do it. Yeah, you use anyone else. I said, no. First, I was very upset, and I said, no. I said, how can you do this?
Okay.
Like, you know me as a friend, and you're taking, you know, issues relating to privacy. And then I thought to myself, this is unfair. So I told this guy, I said, you carry your short story, just change the name, no? Because
Okay. Someone
who knows me or knows me might
so he changed the name.
Then said that I'm not going to carry this short story, which I felt terribly bad about, because I said I'm killed his creativity, and it was quite funny actually, but whatever. So that's how it is.
So finally, what would you like to say for us aspiring writers, authors?
Go for it.
Okay.
The sky is the limit. Dream big. Trust yourselves. Don't stay back. Don't think that because you come from a small place, you are kind of, you know, low achievers. You can't do what someone in a big city did or does. But you need to, you know, you need to work hard. You need to push yourself. And I don't think that life owes us anything. No, we have to reach out and get it. So if we try hard, you are definitely sooner or later going to get it. You know, have faith in yourself. You know, most of us, when we start off, I know what I was when I was your age. I had no confidence. And along the way, if you keep pushing, you get there. You get there, and you'll be surprised where you reach. You know, people like me who believe in, you know, gratitude journaling and being appreciating all that you receive. You know, I feel we've been blessed with a whole lot of more things than we actually deserve. And it's important to build a network, to have groups that take you forward, to have writers groups, to have whatever groups, no? Because we can't do things on our own. And 30 years down the line, 20 years down the line, you say, wow, like that small meeting we started off there, see where it's taken us to. No, it is possible, and you can definitely do it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your time.
And
thank
my
you
last,
for
my last wish is that, you know, if this was audio, we would have all been less self-conscious, and you always remember that I told you this first. You would make a great audio personality, because you're so confident also, not that you're not confident here, but.
Thank you, sir. I told you, after your interview, I will work
Let's
with
see.
Audio.
Let's see.
That was Frederick Noronha, and I'm very grateful that he gave us his time and was so patient during the interview. I would like to thank my colleague, Shubhankar Shah, for helping me organize this interview and for directing it, for all the technical stuff. Thank you, Shubhankar. And I would also like to thank my support system, Valencia, for being there, for just being there. It worked out well for me. I was a little bit less conscious because Sir Frederick is such an amazing person. He's too modest.
No,
when I'm going to say all this, he's going to say, you're going to flatter me. But I'm not flattering him. He is really one hell of a down-to-earth, simple, and a beautiful soul. So thank you, and